Cześć, tu Agata z kanału Izraelia. Witam Was serdecznie w nowym odcinku, bardzo wyczekanym zresztą przez Was, sądząc po komentarzach pod ostatnim postem. Dzisiaj jest ze mną Lia, która opowie historię swojego życia, o tym jak postanowiła, mając 18 lat, całkowicie zmienić swoje życie, odejść ze społeczności Żydów ultraortodoksyjnych w Stanach i żyć takim nowym świeckim życiem. Będziemy rozmawiać po angielsku, więc dla tych, co potrzebują, napisy polskie są dostępne, można je włączyć w prawym albo lewym górnym rogu. Lia ma też swój kanał na YouTubie od jakiegoś czasu i oglądając jej odcinki możecie dowiedzieć się więcej szczegółów z jej życia, także serdecznie zapraszamy, wszystkie linki będą w opisie. Nazwy kanału Lii i do jej social mediów też będą się wyświetlały na ekranie. Hi Lia, I'm very happy that you are here. I really appreciate that you came. Your story is just fascinating and my viewers were waiting for you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm calling you Lia now, but we both know that's not your original name.
Right.
So what would I call you had we met 10 years ago?
Had we met 10 years ago, you would call me Ruth. That's the name that my parents gave me when I was born. I changed it because I just don't feel like that person anymore. No disrespect to anyone named Ruth, there's nothing wrong with the name. I just wanted to kind of disconnect from that life that I had and become someone new.
Why did you choose Lia?
I always loved the name. I always thought it was beautiful. And actually, my parents were planning to name me Leia after my grandfather's mother. And they changed it in the last moment to the other side of the family, after my father's great aunt. So my grandfather was always really offended that not only did they not name me after his mother, but they went to the other side of the family altogether. So since I was changing my name anyway, I said, you know what, let me make it right and I'll use that name. I just wanted to put a little bit of a modern twist and do Lia instead of Leia. And my mom claims, I don't believe this, but my mom claims that she felt her father's soul forgive her when I changed the name. So it works for her.
Wow, sounds amazing. And how would you feel if someone would call you Ruth now? Would you feel like bad, sad memories are coming
back? It's triggering. I hate it. I have certain people who insist on calling me Ruth, and I think it's very disrespectful. Yeah. Yeah, it's just very triggering for me.
So when did you leave the community? How old were you?
Well, I emotionally left when I was like 11 years old or so, 10 or 11 years old. Of course, I was young, still living in my parents' house, so I didn't physically leave until I was 18. And even then, I was still kind of one foot in, one foot out situation. It's a process to leave. It takes a few years. So I would say I was completely out when I was in my early 20s.
Okay, so it wasn't a flash of inspiration, it was something that was growing in your mind for years.
Yeah.
And what made you leave? I guess you have many reasons.
A lot of things. Yeah. A lot of things.
But the main ones, let's say.
I would say the main one was the hypocrisy within the communities. There were things like, you know, people being told not to be friends with me because my skirts were too short, or I didn't know the prayers by heart. And I was treated really, really poorly. And I mean, I'm not a rabbi, what do I know? But I have read the Torah, I have studied it. And personally, it looks to me like you're supposed to be more concerned with how you treat a human being rather than how long my skirt is, or if I know the prayers by heart. Like, you shouldn't care about that, right? You should care how you treat me. And the hypocrisy just really, really bothered me. And I just didn't want to be a part of that community anymore. I didn't want to have anything to do with people who treat someone like that just because they don't necessarily fit in.
But did you think maybe about leaving the community itself, but still staying like religious, or you just wanted to immediately become secular, not having anything to do with
that? Yeah, it's very triggering to me. No, I did try. First of all, I don't believe in God and I don't believe in religion. That's that simple. I did try to stay connected with some of the traditions just for the sake of, you know, this is my heritage. But it's just so triggering for me. It's really difficult. And I had so many bad experiences with synagogue and Sabbath and all of that stuff that now I don't want anything to do with it. I want my space, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I understand. And what about your role when you were a child? Because you were born in that community, or
yes.
your parents joined. No, okay, you were born there. So what was your role there as a child? And what would be your role there as a woman, like adult woman, if you would stay there?
So to clarify, I was born religious. Like my parents are religious. My whole family is religious. We lived in a secular community until I was about 9 years old. And then we moved mm-hmm. to this really closed off religious community. My role there was to try to be as invisible as possible in order to avoid, you know, making men think impure thoughts about me.
Even as a child? Even as a
little
yes. girl?
Oh, yes.
Really?
Yes. And that really irritated me because it wasn't the men's responsibility to make sure that they didn't sin. Mm-hmm. It was my responsibility as the woman to not tempt them to sin. Which, I don't know why men aren't more insulted by this, by the way. It's basically saying you have no control over yourself.
Yeah.
Like, I would be insulted as a man. I'm certainly insulted as a woman. So that was my role. You know, it was don't play sports if it's going to make your skirt ride up. Don't look people in the eye. Don't speak up in public. Definitely don't do something like this. No way. No singing, no dancing. We could do that if it was only women around.
Mm-hmm.
Like I went to an all-girls school, so we were able to sing and dance in the school. But if there's a man around, no way. And it's a very small existence. It's just, you know, trying not to be seen and trying not to be heard as much as possible. Thankfully, my family, my immediate family, is slightly less religious than the community and the school that we were in. So we were, you know, the heathen family of the community. My parents are still religious, but they didn't do that thing where they have 12 kids and the first six have to take care of the mm-hmm. second six. There are families that do that in that community, but mine was not one of them, thankfully.
Okay. And if you would decide to stay there, and you would be, you know, 20, 22 years old, I guess mm-hmm. you would get married, because that's
yes.
what happens, right?
Yes.
That's the order.
Yes.
And you would have children, and would you be able to work or not at all?
I would be able to work, but it'd be very limiting. The expectation for people in that community, particularly for women in the school that I went to, was to go to seminary mm-hmm. as opposed to college or university. So obviously you can only work within the community because you don't actually have credentials to work elsewhere outside.
Yeah.
So what most of the girls do in the school that I went to and what a lot of them my age have done is after high school they went to seminary, usually in Israel, and then they come back and teach at the same high school or they become rebbetzins or mothers, and that's what they do. And there's nothing wrong with that. If that's what you want to do, that's great. I have no problem with that, to each their own. But it's not what I wanted. And there weren't really other options for me within the community.
Okay, and could you specify, you said it was a closed community,
mm-hmm.
closed ultra-Orthodox Jewish community.
Yes.
What does it mean closed? Like, were you allowed to have contact with any secular people, people with different beliefs, people believing in different religion, whatever, like, or just to see the outside world?
No, it's not really about allowed or not allowed. There just wasn't any context for it. Because that community, we had our own schools, our own supermarkets, our own doctors, our own psychologists. There was never opportunity to get to know anyone outside the community or to see a different point of view or a different way of living. It's not that it was forbidden, it's just, where am I going to meet anyone else? And it was absolutely discouraged, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, I just never had the opportunity. And it's a problem that it's so closed because everybody knows everybody. And there's no one to go to. If it's not working for you, there's no one to go to. So like I mentioned, the doctor, the psychologist, they're all in the community,
mm-hmm.
right? They're all friends with my parents. They all go to the same synagogue. So if I'm going to my psychologist Thursday, and then on Friday, they're coming over for the Sabbath dinner, am I going to be able to open up to that psychologist? Of course not.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how it works.
And speaking of discouraging and education, because you used to be a teacher till recently, actually.
Yes, yes.
So you have a great comparison. So I guess that the education in this community, the main focus was on religious education.
Yes, yes.
But did you have any regular lessons, you know, like maths, geography, whatsoever?
They would say yes, and I say no. And I'll explain that. The teachers in the private schools, as I mentioned, they're all from within the community. They all went to seminary. The men went to yeshiva. Mm-hmm. They don't have any formal education in how to be a teacher or in the subject that they're teaching. They're not even licensed by the state to mm-hmm. teach. So I don't know how much they really understood what they were teaching. And, you know, they would get off topic, and what they really wanted to teach us was Torah. So even in the classes that weren't supposed to be about Torah, they would make it about Torah. So for example, we had Jewish history class and we had American history class, taught by the same teacher who was a rabbi and not a licensed teacher. So in the American history class, he started talking about Abraham Lincoln, and he somehow compared him to Moses and then veered off and just started talking about Moses for 20 minutes in the American history class.
Okay.
And I said, I want to go to college one day. I know that's not like the norm, but that's what I want to do. I need to know American history. I need to understand, who is this Abraham Lincoln guy? I don't know who this is. Can we go back to that? And then he got very upset with me and he said, but don't you believe that this is important? We're talking about Moses. This is our history. We need to learn this, which of course got all my classmates against me. And that's how the secular classes went at this school. So there was not a lot of secular learning happening.
So what do you think about it? Do you think that they really believe deep inside, that it's just so important and the only important thing in the world is religion? Or maybe they're aware that you need secular education, but they know at the same time that if you will be more educated, you will be more open-minded and you will be more likely to leave the community one day.
Exactly. Exactly, that's what it is. And obviously I'm speculating, right? I can't mm-hmm. read anyone's mind. But from what I know and from what I have experienced, it's definitely that they don't want you to have options. They want you to stay in the community because there's nowhere else to go. And it works. It's what happens. I know a lot of people who wanted to leave and they didn't because it's too hard and you don't have options outside. So it does work, but that's definitely the intent. I've actually been told that by someone I know who recently had a daughter. I know that this person is eligible for European citizenship. So I mentioned to him, you should get that. I know you don't want to move to Europe, but it opens options for your daughter. Mm-hmm. And he said, I don't want her to have options. I don't want her to leave. So that's just the way it goes.
What was the reaction of your parents when you announced them that you're leaving?
Well, nobody was surprised because, again, I stopped believing. I like emotionally left when I was really young. So when I physically left and moved out, nobody was surprised at all. It was very, very difficult at the time. It really hurt our relationship. I went through a few years in which I did not speak to my mother. It was really tough, but now we're in a very, very good place. We've kind of come to terms with each other and both sides have accepted this is just what it is. We either have to agree to disagree or not have a relationship at all. So we've chosen to agree to disagree.
Do your parents accept that you're secular now and they respect your secular life? Or from time to time, they try to persuade you to do some religious stuff or, I don't know, traditions that you're not practicing anymore?
They try, but it's been getting better and better each time that I'm like, no, this is not going to work. Stop bothering me about this. As I get older, they become more accepting of it. Mm-hmm. I think a big part of the problem is that when I decided to leave, I was so young that they probably thought, oh, she's just being a rebellious teenager. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think they realized how serious the issue was. So as I get older, it gets better and they get more used to it.
Yeah, but they are still in the community. Or they're out of it now?
Well, they moved to Israel now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So they're still in a religious community, but it's a different community and a bit more open, a bit more understanding.
Okay. And what made you choose Israel?
I didn't have too much of a choice. Yeah, I'm going to get a lot of haters for this. I don't love living in Israel. I really don't. And I do plan to leave very soon back to the United States. I really didn't have options because I was in the US, as I mentioned, very little education, no work experience. I didn't have any friends or know anyone in the secular world who was going to help me. And I knew that I needed an education. In my mind, that is the tool to anything you want in life, is yeah. education. So I really, really wanted a university degree. And we all know prices in the United States for universities. So I figured I can, you know, spend my whole life paying off student loans for something that may or may not work out for me. Or I can go to Israel, where I got a lot of scholarships and a lot of opportunities that in the end it made university essentially free for me. So I figured I can do that, and it's gonna suck and I'm not gonna like it, but it's going to get me closer to where I need to be without, you know, getting in over my head.
Yeah, use it as a tool on your way.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Okay. And what about, you know, now we have Netflix and all those platforms with series and movies and all of that. So everyone knows Unorthodox.
Yes.
That's, I think, the most popular. And my viewers very often ask me, Agata, is it true what they show there?
Yes.
Is that how it really looks like? And does it reflect the reality, or rather does it reflect the majority of Orthodox Jews? What do you think? What would you answer?
So there's slightly two different programs on Netflix right now that everyone's talking about. There's Unorthodox and My Unorthodox Life.
Mm-hmm. That's a new one.
Right. Yeah. That's the reality show. Yeah. So Unorthodox, I wasn't in a community like that. I was in a community more similar to Julia Hart's community in My Unorthodox Life. So with Unorthodox, from what I know about those communities, and I do know people have left those communities, it is very, very accurate and very fair from what I know, but I'm not speaking from firsthand experience. In terms of My Unorthodox Life, it's completely accurate, and I know this firsthand, and I actually went to the same school that Julia Hart went to, not in the same location. Mm-hmm. It's a branch of schools. They have it all over the country. They have one in Israel as well. So I went to the same school, and it is 1,000% accurate, for sure. And they were very fair, in my opinion.
But do you think that it's like extreme cases? Because, you know, controversial subjects always sell the best.
Yeah.
It's obvious. They won't show regular Orthodox family, which is living regular life. They are happy.
Of course.
So do you think that it reflects the majority, or it's really like extreme cases?
I would say it's the majority for people who don't fit in these communities. If you fit in, if you believe, if you want to have 12 kids and marry someone who you've known a couple of months, great. It's going to work for you. You're going to have a good time. And there's nothing wrong with that. More power to you. But if you are like myself or Julia Hart or Esty from the show Unorthodox, then that is, you're going to have a very different experience, unfortunately.
So what about the Orthodox people who feel insulted after watching it, or maybe after hearing the feedback, you know, from people who are, first of all, a lot of Orthodox Jews say that it harms their image, their name. So do you think they have a right to feel insulted? What do you think about it? Because you wrote a post about it on Facebook.
I did.
That's why I'm asking.
I did, because I feel so strongly about this. So the Orthodox people who are insulted, I'm hearing two main arguments from them. I hear the argument of, but I grew up Orthodox and I'm a woman and I'm having a great time and I love my life.
Mm-hmm.
Which I don't understand this argument, because I should not have to explain to somebody who is an adult, just because you had one experience doesn't mean that I can't have had a different experience. I don't understand that I have to explain that to someone. What works for you might not work for me, and the other way around. So I don't believe that these shows on Netflix are saying, no, it's impossible to have a good experience while being Orthodox. No, of course not. It's just saying, here's someone who didn't have a good experience. Here's what her situation is like. And I don't think it's fair to try to negate that with, well, I can't relate. So that's the first argument. And the second argument is, you know, unfortunately, there is a lot of anti-Semitism in the world.
Yeah.
And these shows do promote anti-Semitism, unfortunately. It's not the intent. I know that even our conversation now will unfortunately promote some anti-Semitism, and it's not the intent. I'm not against Jews. I'm not against religion. I'm against extremists, and I'm against forcing people to live a certain way. But I know that there are those people who are going to watch this and misinterpret it. But here's the thing. If me talking about how a community treated me is going to force, well, not force, is going to cause people to hate that community, then that's a moment for the community to self-reflect and to say, what are we doing wrong that people hate us when they hear what we've done? That is not a moment to tell me to sit down and shut up.
It's not a responsibility to create their image as a good one.
Of course not. Of course not. I have every right to tell my story and to say what I went through and to say how I feel about it. And as you said, it's not my responsibility to make them look good. It's their responsibility to behave in a way that when I talk about it, they look good.
Yeah. And speaking of like little things, I saw again on your Facebook
yes.
that before you got married, because you got married recently,
yes.
Mazel tov.
Thank you.
That you went for manicure and pedicure, which mm-hmm. is common, like most of the brides are doing it, I guess. But for you, it wasn't something regular, nothing
right.
normal. It was something significant in your life.
Yes.
So why
yes.
was that?
So I'm 29, and yes, it was my first mani-pedi ever. Also, in the past few years, I had my first massage. I went to a spa for the first time. All good experiences. And the thing is, growing up, those things are considered to be gashmias. Gashmias is a Yiddish word, and it means like superficial.
Okay.
And it wasn't forbidden, but it's like you're not supposed to care about how you look. You're not supposed to need, you know, a massage to de-stress. You're not supposed to be focused on materialistic things. You're supposed to learn Torah and marry a nice Jewish boy and have babies. That's what you're supposed to be focused on. So it took a long time for me in my brain to be okay with spending time on my appearance and on my self-care and just on time to myself. It really took a long time to kind of deprogram myself from the idea of, oh, I'm being superficial, I'm being a snob, this is gashmias, I shouldn't do it.
How did it feel? Was it stressful for you?
No, it was amazing. It was amazing. I loved it. My mom took me, actually.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. We've come a long way. My mom took me, and it was amazing. I felt like a queen, and it was just such a good experience. I felt like I needed that as part of my growth. You know, in my new life and who I'm becoming, that was a big step for me. There was a tiny part of my brain that said all the things that I knew the religious people would be saying to me. Oh, you're superficial. Oh, why do you care about this? Oh, why are you spending money on this? But I just shut it down. I was like, don't ruin this for me. I'm having a good time.
Yeah. About shutting down, do you still have any habits that you do? Maybe you don't even agree with them, but you are doing them out of habit.
Yes, unfortunately, I'm really, really working on it. Something very, very dangerous that they teach us when we're young is everything happens for a reason, God has a plan, and anything good or bad that happens to you, God is doing as reward or punishment for something you have done. And why is that dangerous? Because sometimes bad things happen to mm-hmm. people. It happens, life happens. And when you're already suffering from whatever bad thing has happened to you, and then on top of that, you're like, oh no, what did I do to deserve this? What did I do wrong? Why is God angry at me? Why does God hate me? That's horrible for your self-esteem, for your healing from whatever happened. It's really, really dangerous. I know when I was younger in fourth grade, there was a girl who, there was a fire in her house, one of the girls in my class, and she got burns all over her body. So of course she was away from school and the hospital and everything. And she was the sweetest girl, nicest girl. And we were all talking about it in school as kids do. And one of the kids said, I wonder what she did that God did this to her. And the teacher didn't say, it's not true, it doesn't work like that, sometimes fires happen. No, yeah. The teacher said, that's not our business to figure out. It's so dangerous. And I still think like that when something happens to me, I'm like, oh, what did I do to deserve this? And I'm trying really hard to deprogram that, but it's very difficult to do.
How long it took you to get used to secular life? Like you came to Israel, it was mm-hmm. double hard, I guess, because it was a different country, but
yes.
Or maybe it was easier because you kind of left it behind and you were disconnected. I don't know, you tell me.
In ways it was easier because Israel is a very Jewish culture, so
yeah.
it wasn't like everything was new. It's like, oh, okay, I know what that is. Oh, the holiday, yeah, I know that one. But at the same time, it is, as you said, a different culture. It is a different language. So it was a lot of learning everything.
You spoke Yiddish?
I speak a bit of Yiddish. I'm not fluent.
Okay.
In my house...
The community was speaking English?
Yeah, we speak in English and Yiddish mixed.
Okay.
So I speak a couple words here and there. I always confuse my Yiddish and my Hebrew, actually. Mm. it was very, very difficult. It took quite a few years to adjust just because there's so many things that I had to train myself to do in the religious community that don't work in the secular world. Something that I'm still working on is to look people in the eye. I was always taught, don't look people in the eye, especially men. It's inviting. You need to look down. You want to be small. you know? And now when I'm talking to people and I won't look them in the eye, it looks sketchy. They're like, are you lying to me? Do you not like me? What's going on? So there's definitely things to work on. It's definitely challenging.
When it comes to men, when you came to Israel, I guess after some time you started dating.
Yes.
Secular guys.
Yes.
So how was it? Because, you know, you didn't have to do all these things that you were used to in your community. You didn't have to be so modest. And as we can see, she's not modest anymore.
I went the other way.
So I'm very curious about dating. How was it?
Well, I screwed up a lot because I was kind of raised with this idea of you want to get married and you want to have kids and your entire self-worth is dependent on, does someone want to marry you and have children with you? And if nobody wants you by the age you're like 23, there's something wrong with you. So my whole self-worth was tied up in that. So I dated these awful guys who would treat me like crap. And I was like, oh, he wants to be with me. He'll marry me. You know, like, he could have treated me however he wanted. If he said he would marry me, I would put up with it. And thankfully, I don't do that anymore. But it took a few years to, you know, find my voice and find my strength and be able to actually choose who I want to be with and ask myself, do I like this person? Rather than, is this person going to marry me?
Yeah. Does he like me?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what made you want to leave Israel after 10 years, right? 10 years.
Yeah, I've been here 10 years. Even when I first came here, it was never my intention to stay in the long term. I came here with kind of the idea of I'm going to take what I need from it and then move on. And so, you know, I built up my resume. I worked for many years. I got some really, really strong referrals for after I move and want to work elsewhere. I got my education. I have 2 degrees, actually, which is amazing. I never thought I would have that. So I feel like done. I feel ready. I got everything I need. And as you said, I recently got married. We want to have children soon, and I do not want to raise our children here. It's still a religious country at the end of the day. And it would be a little bit hypocritical of me to leave the closed religious community just to raise my children in a different religious context. I want my children to be free and have all the choices in the world and no outside pressure whatsoever to believe X, Y, or Z. So my husband and I are going to move to the United States and raise our children there.
He's Israeli, right?
Yeah, he's Israeli, but he grew up in England.
Oh, okay.
So he kind of was in the same mindset. He also said that he would always leave Israel. So we're on the same page.
Okay. Do you have something that you miss from your old life?
Is it bad if I say no?
No, it's actually great. It's great for you.
I don't want to sound ungrateful or anything, but no.
Okay, that's good for you.
Well, I miss being close with my brothers.
Oh, okay.
That's something that I miss.
Are you in touch with them or not at all?
We're not actively not in touch. Like, we can be in the same room together, you know? It's not like, oh, I'm not speaking to him or something like that. But just, there's so much distance now. The list of things that we can't talk about is always growing. The list of things we resent each other for is always growing. And each side feels like there's always something new that we have to accept about the other one that's difficult for us. It just doesn't work, unfortunately. So we're not nearly as close as we used to be. So that's something that I miss.
Don't you miss being a part of community? Because the only good thing that comes to my mind, you know, about being in such a community, for me, obviously, it's my personal opinion, is that you feel like you have someone's back, you know. There is always someone around. You are never alone. There are people to help you.
And if you are part of the community, if you fit in, then that is the experience. And it's amazing, I'm sure. I see it from the outside. It looks like a very nice thing to have. Yeah. But I never fit in. So I never had that. I was always the community outcast because I didn't believe. So I just don't have that experience.
So one more thing. Some people say that becoming secular, leaving like religious communities is the easy way out because secular life is easier.
Yes.
You don't have all these things to do, traditional stuff, habits, duties. What do you think about it?
So it kind of infuriates me when people say that because I get that a lot. People from my old community are like, oh, you left because you don't like rules. You don't like being told what to do. You don't want to live a difficult life. No, for me and for many, many people like me, the easy way out, the easy thing to do is to stay. because everything is laid out for you. You have everything you need.
You don't have to start from the beginning.
Exactly. You have everything there. And, you know, if you fit into the community, they're very accepting and very loving if you fit in. Mm-hmm. So that's easy. The difficult thing to do in my situation was to leave because it turned everyone against me. And I had to start from scratch without any of the tools that I needed. So no, being atheist is not the easy way out in any circumstance.
Yeah, I totally agree. Thank you very much, Leah, for today. I'm sure that my viewers are super excited about this video.
Thank you.
And I think that, you know, first when I heard your story, you seemed to me so brave and so courageous.
Thank you.
Because you just started from scratch.
Thank you.
But now you seem to me even braver because you also share your story publicly and openly. So it's really amazing.
Thank you.
Thank you
very
much.